to talk about the work that we've been doing over the last couple of years, but particularly to focus on work and curiosity, which has been a relatively newer focus of my interest. So I would say over the last 7 years. And as was mentioned, I do have a book that just came out with my twin, Perry Zern, who happens to be a philosopher. And so this book is called Curious Minds, and it addresses the intersection between the philosophy, neuroscience, and network science of curiosity. So what I'll be doing today is actually focusing on mathematical models of curiosity. It's a super tiny sliver of what's actually in the book, but I thought it was the sliver that might bring some interest from this particular audience. Okay, so to begin, what is curiosity? Is it an emotion or a behavior? A cognitive process? Curiosity seems to be a relatively abstract concept, like love, perhaps, or justice, far from the realm of those bits of nature that mathematics can possibly address. However, contrary to intuition, it turns out that the leading theories of curiosity are surprisingly amenable to formalization in the mathematics of network science. And so in this talk, I will unpack some of those theories and show how they can be formalized in the mathematics of networks. Then I'll describe evidence from human behavior and linguistic corpora and ask which theories that evidence actually supports. Throughout, I'll make a case for the position that individual and collective curiosity are both network building processes, providing a connective counterpoint to the common acquisitional account of curiosity in humans. So what is curiosity? Again, when I pronounce that term, several images may come to your mind. Perhaps you think of the classical board game, Trivial Pursuit, or you think of the older child asking an unending string of questions, or perhaps you think of the beautiful sight of hands raised in a classroom. Perhaps curiosity is the love of trivia, or perhaps curiosity is the asking of questions. But I think we can all think of curious individuals in our lives who do not enjoy playing Trivial Pursuit. Maybe they're curious in a different way. And we can probably all think of curious individuals who do not verbalize many questions. Perhaps they are relatively shy or more thoughtful. So what is curiosity? And what makes a human curious? The quandary of how to define curiosity, its places and its actions, is not a challenge that we newly face. Instead, it has been faced by many before us. And there have been many different answers to the question. We can go back, for example, to Augustine in 397, who suggested that curiosity is a lust to experience and find out. Or Thomas Aquinas in 1270 wrote that curiosity is the desire to know. Descartes in 1649 said that curiosity is a desire to understand. John Locke in 1693 writes that curiosity is an appetite after knowledge. William James in 1899 suggests that curiosity is the impulse toward better cognition. John Dewey in 1933 suggests that curiosity is an interest in problems provoked by the observations of things and the accumulation of material. Voss in 1983 suggests that curiosity is a motivational prerequisite of exploratory behavior. And George Lowenstein in 1994 writes that curiosity is a feeling of deprivation produced by information gaps. We're going to come back to that idea later, actually. And Kidd in 2015 writes that curiosity is a drive state for information. So if we think about all of these different definitions or suggestions, we can ask, what is it precisely that we are desirous of, or impulsive towards, or interested in, or deprived of, or driven towards? The answers, I think, knowledge, information, solutions to problems, better cognition, are commonly thought of as items, which when acquired are really satisfying. In fact, the analogy between hunger and thirst and curiosity, as well as the analogy between food and drink and information, underscores the acquisitional nature of our very common conceptualizations. Moreover, we think of curiosity as valuable to us because when we acquire a bit of information, our life gets better. Our uncertainty about the world is reduced, and we no longer feel deprived of information. Upon reflection, this acquisitional account of curiosity seems intuitive. Yet, if we press the account, and if we allow acquisitional actions of humans to play out upon the theater of our experience, we quickly come to realize that we are missing a key piece of the puzzle. An acquisition or collection of informational bits does not constitute knowledge. Knowledge requires something more. Knowledge requires an understanding of the relations between bits of information, relations of cause, of correlations, of consequence, to name a few. As Dewey writes, knowledge is a perception of those connections of an object which determine its applicability in a given situation. An ideally perfect knowledge would represent such a network of interconnections that any past experience would offer a point of advantage from which to get at the problems presented in a new experience. Or we could consider the perspective of Henri Poincaré when he writes, the aim of science is not things themselves, as the dogmatists in their simplicity imagine, but the relations among things. Outside these relations, there is no reality knowable. So how might we expand the current acquisitional account of curiosity to an explicitly connectional account of curiosity? And if we did so, what sorts of affordances might such an account offer? Well, the connectional account of curiosity casts curious humans as those who build networks. They build by adding nodes and edges as they grow their body of knowledge. Or using a more embodied description, curious minds engage in a kinesthetic practice by walking through a knowledge space and picking up relations to structure their thought architectures. The knowledge network inside each mind is therefore constantly evolving and growing in manners and directions that are idiosyncratic. We walk along the links that connect bits of information, and then we stand and notice empty spaces, maybe sort of shout across, what is that over there? When we find or discover a unit of information that fully or partially fills the void, we have built a new bit of scaffold in our knowledge network. In this kind of framing, we can now ask, what is curiosity's walk? Is there just one, or is there more than one? How are curiosity's walks similar or different? Which walk do you choose? Which walk do I choose? With those questions in mind, I want to explicitly clarify the structure of the talk. So what I'd like to do over the next couple of minutes as we try to address those questions is to first test philosophical theories of individual curiosity. And here I will be discussing a paper that was published in 2021, led by David Lydon-Staley in the lab. After that, I want to test some philosophical theories of collective curiosity. And that is work that's just coming out from Harang Zhu in Collective Intelligence. And then in the final section, I'd like to turn from philosophical theories to psychological theories. And I'll talk about recent work that's just a preprint on archive and is currently under review. And I know that part of the goal of these talks is to show you new hot off the presses kind of stuff. And so that last section is one where you'll be able to see what I'm thinking about most right now. Okay, so let's test some philosophical theories of individual curiosity. First, in order to do that, let's go back through the past 2 million years, because obviously that's what we want to do this afternoon, right? And this is what Perry Zern did. He's a professor of philosophy at American University. He also happens to be my twin and the co-author of the book Curious Minds that I mentioned earlier. So what he did is that he used a historical philosophical method where he searched for the terms for curiosity in the Western intellectual canon over the last 2 million years. And he particularly focused on a couple different languages, Greek, Latin, French, German, and English, and studied where that term arose, as well as some synonymous phrases. And he also studied interrogative sentences. And the goal in using this historical philosophical method was to identify styles of curiosity that have been present throughout the last 2000 years. And he identified 3 different styles from that canon. What we'll do after we identify the styles is to show how we can quantify them in the language of network science. So the first style is what is traditionally called the busybody, but you can also think about it as kind of a butterfly. So this one is described really nicely in Plutarch. in his On Curiosity, where he says, "And the busybody, shunning the country as something stale and uninteresting and undramatic, pushes into the bar and the marketplace, bazaar and the marketplace and the harbors, asking, is there any news?" And also Martin Heidegger in Being and Time writes that curiosity, or the curious person, is actually curiosity is the not staying with what is nearest, or the distraction by new possibilities, or this is my favorite, the never dwelling anywhere. So this kind of person, or this sort of style, is someone who loves to connect disconnected bits of information. So goes into the bazaar and the marketplace and the harbors asking, is there any news? It doesn't matter if that news is connected to anything else that this person knows. It just matters that it's news, right? And this never dwelling anywhere, similarly, it's like, I'll take this piece of information, I'll take that, anything is fine. So we can think about the busybody as someone who's building a knowledge of relatively disconnected informational bits. You can think of trivia too here. Let's contrast that with the hunter. So here, again, from Plutarch's On Curiosity, if you have to be curious, basically don't, but if you have to be, don't turn aside and follow every scent, but keep your sense of smell pure and untainted for its proper task. And then Jacques Derrida in The Animal That Therefore I Am writes, to be curious is to track, to sniff, to trail, and to follow some of the reasons for the so confident usage of words. And then Nietzsche, in his Beyond Good and Evil, writes, the man of curiosity wishes he had a few hundred helpers and good, well-trained hounds that he could drive into the history of the human soul to round up his game. What you can see clearly from these simple passages is that the hunter is someone who follows or tracks and moves along a particular trail of knowledge. So we can think about this style as somebody who is really interested in connecting pieces of information in a direction. So I'm going to think about this as a knowledge of connected informational units constructed by this sort of person. And then the third and final style that I wanted to describe for you is the dancer. And this one is illustrated in Nietzsche's Gay Science, where he writes about thinkers of the future. And he says, we do not belong to those who have ideas only among books or when stimulated by books. It is our habit to think outdoors, walking, leaping, climbing, dancing, preferably on lonely mountains or near the sea, where even the trails become thoughtful. Our first questions about the value of a book, of a human being, or a musical composition are, can they walk even more? Can they dance? And he's asking that in a sort of more intellectual way, not necessarily in a physical way. And then from Michel Foucault in The Masked Philosopher, he says, I can't help but dream about a kind of criticism that would try not to judge, but to bring an avoir, a book, a sentence, an idea to life. It would light fires, watch the grass grow, listen to the wind and catch the sea foam in the breeze and scatter it. It would multiply not judgments, but signs of existence. It would summon them, drag them from their sleep. Perhaps it would invent them sometimes, all the better. I'd like a criticism of scintillating leaps of the imagination. I dream of a new age of curiosity. And in both of these cases, what we see, and also from many other passages that I don't have time to read out loud for you today, we see this style of curiosity where someone may be moving in a particular knowledge space and then leaps to another in an imaginative movement. And for this, then, we would imagine that that person would build a knowledge of connected clusters of information connected by leaps. So we would see a long distance leap to another cluster of knowledge and then a leap to another cluster of knowledge. And that's what this person would build in their minds. So now what I'd like to do, now that we've sort of seen that from the perspective of someone who works in philosophy and sort of the history of philosophy, now I'd like to turn to using the tools of modern science to determine whether those kinds of styles of curiosity are present today. And this is work that was led by David Lyden Staley, who's now a professor in the Annenberg School of Communication at the University of Pennsylvania. And what he did is that he thought, well, you know, when we move from book to book or from paper to paper or from web page to web page, we're building knowledge networks. So we can actually see what sorts of knowledge networks we build. And he focused particularly on Wikipedia because that's something that we can have people browse in a laboratory experiment, and we can study which pages they're moving through and which steps they're taking versus not taking. And that allows us to reconstruct the network of information that they are acquiring as they are browsing. So what happens when curious humans are in action, browsing Wikipedia? Well, in this particular case, what we have is 149 participants in this study who browsed for 15 minutes a day for 21 days each. So that's over 5 hours of data for each person. And collectively, over the course of the experiment, 18,654 pages of Wikipedia were visited. For each person, we can estimate or we can calculate the distance between two Wikipedia pages, and we use the term frequency inverse document frequency. So that's a way of assessing the similarity in the words in one page versus another page. And so that we used that as the weight to link different edges. The weight to link the edges between different pages. So what I'm showing you here on the right-hand side is the three different people, one whose edges are relatively dark, so that means that these pages have a low cosine similarity between them, another who's sort of intermediate, and then a third who's has a very high cosine similarity. So that means they're moving between very similar pages. And as an example, one of the people who was present in the study tended to read about the royal family for the full 21 days. And that person is someone whose cosine similarity was very high. There was another person who tended to focus on Jewish history, again, for the full 21 days. Whereas there were others who decided to move between pretty disparate pages. Okay, so now what we can do with that information is we can test some network hypotheses of whether this historical philosophical taxonomy still makes sense in the context of today's modern world. So the way that we did that is that we said the hunter, our hypothesis is that the hunter is somebody who's going to build a network with relatively high clustering and relatively low path length. That means they're building connective structures as a hunter would. And we would contrast that with a busybody who's going to be creating something that has very little clustering and therefore a relatively long path length in the network. So these are two different structures that are consistent with the two different styles of curiosity. We also added a measure of a personality measure to this study, and that is the measure of deprivation sensitivity. So people who are high in deprivation sensitivity have a drive to eliminate the unknown as they encounter new information and recognize gaps in their knowledge. So if you see a gap in your knowledge and that drives you to fill it, you have what's called deprivation sensitivity. You feel sensitive to being deprived of the information that you know is there. And so all of us vary significantly on how much deprivation sensitivity we have. Our hypothesis was that the people who have very high deprivation sensitivity are more like the hunters. Those are the people who are going to seek out the piece of information that they're missing or follow the trail that they know exists and that they don't have access to yet. Whereas people who are lower on deprivation sensitivity are going to be more like the busybodies. They don't really need to fill in the gaps. They just need any information.
Are questions allowed?
Yes.
Did you characterize the dancer?
Not in this study, no.
Thank you.
But I have lots of ideas about how to do that. And that actually comes back at the very final section of the talk. So maybe hold that. So here's the data. So here along the x-axis is the deprivation sensitivity. Every data point here is a single individual, and along the y-axis are the two network statistics that we were interested in. One is the clustering coefficient, and then the other one is the characteristic path length. And what we find is that there's a large variability among people. Some are very busybody-like, so those individuals who have low clustering coefficients also tend to have high path lengths, and they also tend to be relatively low on deprivation sensitivity. In contrast, people who are building these networks with a high clustering coefficient, so the hunters, tend to have very high deprivation sensitivity and relatively short path lengths. So what we see from these data is that we as humans today are spanning this continuum from busybody to hunter, and we each seek information relatively differently, which also means that we are constructing really different networks of knowledge insides of our mind. Oh, I will mention, actually, just before I move to the second section, is that we also study the variability of these phenotypes over time. So is somebody who's a busybody on day one of the experiment also a busybody on day 21? And the answer is that if we break the data down into sectors of sort of early browsing, middle browsing, and late browsing, we see that if a person is a busybody on the first sector, they will tend to stay like a busybody throughout the time period, but they may move a little bit. It's not a strict trait. There's a little bit of state dependence, but not a lot. So that's just to say that we may each have a tendency towards one spot on this scale, but we may also flexibly move along that scale throughout a 21-day period. Okay.
We have a question.
Yes. Go ahead.
On the last slide, what's the scale, like what is a -3 compared to a -1 in deprivation sensitivity? Like how is that characterized, I guess? Or I don't know how you plot that. Like what is that exactly?
Yeah, so there's a scale for deprivation sensitivity that you can probably just Google. And there are, you know, it's scored so that people who are, or score the average of everybody who was tested on to create that scale tends to be at the zero mark. And then people who score less than zero are ones that tend to be, have less deprivation sensitivity than the average person evaluated in the construction of the scale. And people who are higher tend to have more. I don't know if that answers your question though. It's just very sort of normative variability. We don't see here strong, like very large outliers on the deprivation sensitivity scale among these 149 individuals, but which is good. But it is possible to have lower and higher scores.
I think part of the question is, what is the data point that the deprivation sensitivity is based off of?
It's a scale. So in psychology, there are these things called scales, which are questionnaires. And so it's a set of questions that but they're called scales in psychology, which is developed, the set of questions is developed to assess a particular psychological construct, in this case, deprivation sensitivity. And they are constructed over, you know, carefully. There's a whole organization around or structure around that kind of work. It's a method where questions are asked to determine whether or not they have variability in the human population. And if there isn't a lot of variability or the questions are confusing to people, then those questions are removed and new questions are added. And so there's an iterative development of this questionnaire or scale so that all of the questions matter and provide information that varies across individuals. And number two, that on average, if a person takes the scale two times, they're going to score really similarly. So that's sort of ensuring the reproducibility of the results. You can look up psychological scale or the scale of deprivation sensitivity online and you'll be able to find it.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, so now what I'd like to do is to move from the philosophical theories of individual curiosity to some philosophical theories of collective curiosity, so that we know that each of us are curious as individuals, but we also know that in groups we have particular kinds of curiosity. If you get a bunch of scientists together, you will see their curiosity evinced in particular ways that may be different than the curiosity in other spaces. So what I want to ask now is, what are some of the philosophical theories of collective curiosity? And in order to do that, this is work that was done in collaboration with faculty in the philosophy of science and the history of science here at the University of Pennsylvania. And we focused on three thinkers. We could have expanded more, but we focused on three, particularly Kuhn, who in 1962 suggests that science progresses through periods of what's called normal science, separated by paradigm shifts. The second thinker that we studied was Fire Robin, who around 1975 suggests that science, in science, there is no characteristic pattern to the development of ideas. And then Lakatos around 1970 suggests that science progresses as a research program, which has core postulates and then auxiliary hypotheses. So each of these theories can be instantiated in the framework of network science, and we do that using Wikipedia again. But now, instead of having humans browse Wikipedia, we treat Wikipedia as a repository of scientific knowledge from which we can understand the development and growth of scientific knowledge. So what we build here is a growing network where each page is a node in the network and each hyperlink is an edge in the network. We then also estimate the date for the main concept presented in the page by looking at the history section and identifying the first date in the history section. If you want to visualize any of the fields of science that you may be interested in, Harong has a GitHub repository here that allows for a really nice visualization of these data. So feel free to check it out when you have time, if you like. So let's recast, using that kind of data, let's recast the three thinkers in terms of network science. So first, Kuhn, this sort of normal science is described as puzzle solving. And when we think about puzzles, we think about placing a piece of a puzzle and connecting it to the other pieces around it. So we think about networks that have relatively high clustering. So we're going to say that if puzzle solving is happening, we should see a high clustering coefficient in these data. Now, if we turn to Lakatos, this is the thinker who suggests that there's a research program with a core of postulates and then an auxiliary belt of hypotheses. If Lakatos is right, then we should see core periphery structure in the networks of science concepts in Wikipedia. So we should see a core of concepts that are densely connected to one another, and then a periphery of auxiliary hypotheses that are less well connected to one another. And then if Fire Robin is right, so Fire Robin is the one who said there's no characteristic pattern to scientific development, then we may see more of a random network structure. So let's ask, of the science concept networks in Wikipedia, which of these might fit best? Well, here what I'm showing you is the different science concept networks are the different data points in each plot. Along the y-axis is the real value of the statistic, here clustering coefficient, and then along the x-axis is the value expected in an edge rewired random null model. And what the dashed line here is the unity line. So what you can see is the data points lie above the unity line, which suggests that these science concept networks have greater clustering coefficient than expected in an edge rewired null model. You can also see a similar effect if you study modularity. So that's the tendency for the network to be clustered into small modules with dense connectivity inside and sparse connectivity between modules. Again, what you see is that their real data sit largely above the unity line, suggesting that science concept networks tend to be relatively modular. And then we also evaluated the coreness statistic. And here you can see again that that lies above the unity line. So that's the tendency for science concept networks to have a core of densely interconnected concepts and then an auxiliary belt of or periphery of less connected concepts. So the fact that each of these data groups tends to be above the unity line and far from what you would expect in an edge-rewired null model suggests that there is non-random structure in these networks. And so I'm going to set Fire Robin's description aside for the moment and focus instead on Kuhn and Lakatos. So let's do Lakatos first. Lakatos's idea was that there's this research program where there's a core set of postulates and then an auxiliary belt of hypotheses. And those core postulates are thought to be born relatively early. And then the periphery comes later, this auxiliary belt comes later. So we wanted to ask the question, are the core nodes in these networks born earlier than the periphery or later than the periphery or neither? So here what you see are the names of each of the science concept networks. Along the y-axis here is time, where if it's in the top part here, that's when the core is born earlier. If it's in the bottom part, that means that the periphery is born earlier. And then the zero line indicates that neither is born before the other. And what you can see here is that for most of these violin plots, the central part of the distribution is centered around zero, indicating that there is no tendency for the core ideas to be born earlier than the periphery ideas or vice versa. So they are born on average at the same time. And so that makes us think that we can put Lakatos's research program aside for a second and dig in a little bit more to Kuhn's idea. So what we've seen so far is that science concept networks are clustered and modular, not random. They have cores and peripheries, and they simultaneously grow outward to the periphery and inward to fill the core. Neither is growing before the other. We are simultaneously growing outward and growing inward. So could Kuhn be right? Is normal science a process of puzzle solving or of filling in knowledge gaps? To answer that question, we used persistent homology, which is a tool in the field of applied algebraic topology that allows us to identify cavities or holes or gaps in networks. So we applied these ideas or this particular tool to the science concept networks to identify the lifetime of gaps or cavities in the network and also the number of cavities that are present. And the real data is shown here in the darker navy. The edge-rewired null model is shown in the peach. And then we also have a genetic algorithm, which I'm not going to discuss, and that's shown in the teal color. And so what we find is that the real networks tend to have shorter lifetimes of cavities than the edge-rewired null models. So what that means is that the real networks are filling in gaps faster than would be expected in the edge-rewired null model. We also find that there are fewer open gaps or cavities in the real data in comparison to the edge-rewired null model. So that suggests to us that science concept networks are growing in such a way that they fill gaps faster and create fewer gaps than would be expected if this network were growing in an edge rewired sort of random way. We also asked the question of whether those gaps were important for the way that we value science. So why is it that we fill gaps and why do we not allow gaps to persist for very long or have very many of them? One way to address that question is to ask whether the ideas that have been awarded Nobel Prizes are ideas that fill a gap in the network, or are they ideas that create a gap in the network, or are they ideas that have nothing to do with gaps in the network? So what we find here again in the dark blue, sort of black, is the Nobel Prize winning idea pages, and then in the peach is the non-Nobel Prize winning pages. And what you see is that there is, we find that the influential nodes are those, so those that are awarded a Nobel Prize are those that are more frequently participating in both the birth, which is what you see here, the birth simplex, and the death, which is what you see here, of these gaps. So what that suggests is that Nobel Prize winning ideas are those that either birth or close a cavity, but they are not unconnected to cavities. So it suggests that gaps are important for how we value ideas in science. So what have we learned? Well, what we've learned is that scientific concept networks are built in a really interesting way where they're certainly clustered and they're modular, they're not random. They also have a core typically and a periphery, but neither the core nor the periphery is born first. We tend to fill out the core and push the boundaries, the frontiers of the periphery at the same time. So we're growing inward and outward at the same time. Some of the ideas that have been awarded Nobel Prizes are those that are participating in either the filling of gaps or the creation of new gaps. And interestingly, we can create these gaps inside of the core or outside of the core. And so that means we can grow inwardly or outwardly. And both of those are valued in the way that science develops. Okay, so that takes me to the very last bit that I wanted to tell you about, which is testing some psychological theories of curiosity. And then I'll make sure that we have enough time for questions. So psychological theories, I told you earlier that George Lowenstein thought that information gaps were really important in driving our sense of curiosity or the curiosity that's inside of us. And he developed what's called the information gap theory. So the idea of the information gap theory from psychology is that it views curiosity as the drive to obtain information that's missing from the mental world. But that's not the only theory that's out there from the psychological perspective. A second theory that exists is called compression progress theory. And this views curiosity as a drive to obtain information that improves the compression of your mental model and thereby lowers its cost of representation. So if you're building a network model in your mind of the knowledge that exists in the world and it's relatively compressible, that's nice because it lowers the cost of representing that information. So one of the ideas out there is that when we build our networks of knowledge, we're building it in such a way that it becomes more and more compressible. And then the third and final theory is one that we've developed. It's called the conformational change theory. And this views information seeking behavior as resulting in the creation of a really expansive knowledge network that's embedded in a conceptual geometry. And I'll show you sort of how that works as we go along. So here are the three different models. I want to first ask, what are the mental affordances of these models? Well, the information gap theory, what is that going to do? If you always fill gaps and never create any, then you're going to be creating a rather dense network. So this theory would predict that you would have a network with relatively high density because you're always filling in the gaps, right? It also means that you could have relatively high cognitive rigidity because there are no spaces that allow for changes in the organization of the network. So you can think about networks as having mechanical features where if you fill all of the triangles, that network is going to be relatively rigid, just like a scaffolding that's composed of all triangles. Whereas if you have a network that has holes in it, it can be flexible and can change its shape. And that would be similar to sort of changing your mind or rethinking something you knew before, re-envisioning how knowledge is structured. Now let's think about compression progress theory. What's that going to predict? Well, if you're always building something that is more compressible, you will also be increasing network density because if you have a fully dense network, you can collapse that down in very simply or compress it very simply with very little information. So the compression progress theory is going to predict high network density, also high cognitive rigidity, again, because all of the holes are being filled. But it's going to decrease the cost of representation. So that's the benefit of this one. Conformational change theory is different than both of those in the first two variables. So it suggests that what we are searching for is a network that it remains flexible. So we fill in some holes, but not all of them. And we expand out to a degree that we always have holes. We always have cavities that allow for a reconfiguration, a conformational change of the network structure. So that means that we're going to predict that the networks have relatively low density that provides cognitive flexibility rather than rigidity. But the downside is that it needs a relatively costly representation. So unlike compression progress theory, we're going to have to pay some mental effort for building this kind of network in our minds. Okay, so now that we know the mental affordances, what are some of the mathematical instantiations of these theories? Well, the information gap theory, I already sort of told you that we can use persistent homology from applied algebraic topology to study what are called Betty numbers, which are an assessment of the gaps or cavities in the network. We've done that before for language networks in an earlier paper from Ann Sizemore. So that's what we're going to use here. For compression progress theory, we can actually use information theory to calculate the compressibility of a network. And here we'll particularly use work from Chris Lin that he just published last year. And then for conformational change theory, we will use mechanics to calculate the conformational degrees of freedom of these networks that are being built. And that's derived from work from Jason Kim in the lab that was published in 2019. Okay, the data that we are going to study is the same data that I've described to you before. It's where individuals are walking through Wikipedia, they're browsing Wikipedia, so walking on a knowledge network, and we are able to catalog exactly which pages they move between and how distant they are from one another. So let's test the first theory, the information gap theory. Here, what you can see are cavities, cycles, or gaps. I should choose one word instead of using them all interchangeably. The field sort of uses many of them interchangeably, but I will address that. Let's call them gaps. So Along the y-axis here is are the gaps in the network. Along the x-axis is the time. So as people are building the networks, that is time. Time is evolving as they're building, as they're browsing. And what you can see is the true data is given in the color in green, and then the edge rewired null model is given in purple. So what we see is that there are fewer zero dimensional gaps than expected in the edge rewired null model. So that is supportive of the information gap theory. So yes, people are filling in these gaps and not allowing very many of them to be built. If you look at one dimensional cavities, you see the same thing. So what people are doing, what real humans are doing, building networks that have very few gaps. But if you go to the two-dimensional cavities, humans sort of surprise you in their complexity. And what you see here in the color is that they are having significantly more two-dimensional gaps than expected in the edge-rewired null model. So purple in all three figures is the edge-rewired null model. So that's interesting. That means that the information gap theory explains to some degree what's happening in one and two dimensions, but definitely doesn't explain what's happening in, or sorry, zero and one dimensions, but definitely doesn't explain what's happening in two dimensions. So that means there's something else going on. What else could be going on? Well, we can study the compression progress theory and say, are humans building networks that are relatively compressible as they browse Wikipedia? And the answer is yes. So here's the network compressibility in red. And then in purple, you see the compressibility of an edge rewired null model. You can see that people are building very compressible networks. Great. Okay, so this is in support of compression progress theory. So we've got a little bit of evidence in favor of information gap theory, definite evidence in favor of compression progress theory. What about the conformational change theory? So this is when we assess the conformational degrees of freedom of the network that people are building. And so here, what we find is that the human built networks have many more conformational degrees of freedom than expected in the edge rewired null model. So the color here, the sort of magenta is the humans, and then in purple is the edge rewired null model. So you can see there are many more degrees of freedom in the human built networks. So let's put those three pieces of data together on one slide so that you can see them at once. What evidence is there for the information gap theory? We definitely see gaps being filled and very few gaps being created in 0D and 1D, but in 2D, there are a lot of gaps in the human-built networks. Compression progress theory is definitely supported, and conformational change theory is also supported. So I want to ask the question of, is there some utility to having all three of these mechanisms at play in the human mind as we are browsing or as we are being curious? So in other words, what does this combination of mechanisms afford for us? Well, it affords a balance between cognitive rigidity and cognitive flexibility. So these two theories, the first two, are going to drive cognitive rigidity, whereas the third is driving cognitive flexibility. The fact that we see evidence for all three suggests that there may be a balance between growing your network to enable some amount of rigidity and some amount of flexibility. Having all three mechanisms at play also provides a balance between relatively costly versus relatively cheap mental representations. The highly compressible networks are going to be relatively cheap to maintain, but these ones with large degrees of freedom in terms of conformational change will be relatively costly. So again, perhaps people are balancing between costly and cheap mental representations. Okay, so that brings me back to where we started. We started by saying that there are different theories of curiosity that are provided either by the field of philosophy or by the field of psychology. And some of them are specific to individual curiosity. Some of them are specific to collective curiosity. But in all three cases, what I asked is, how can we instantiate those theories in the mathematics of network science and use that instantiation to assess evidence for versus against each of the theories? And what we found, in summary, is that individual and collective curiosity can be operationalized as network building processes, and network statistics can then be used to test the validity of either the philosophical or the psychological theories of curiosity. In part one, we found evidence for these ancient philosophical styles of curiosity being relatively alive and well today in the browsing of Wikipedia. The browsing. I had to do that because it's ancient styles, right? Okay, part two. We find evidence for Kuhn's normal science, but not Fire Robin's characteristicless process or Lakatos's research program. And then in part three, we find evidence for the information gap theory, the compression progress theory, and the conformational change theories in psychology, which each offer different cognitive affordances for humans. But collectively, this work provides a connective counterpoint to the very common acquisitional account of curiosity in humans. Each of the studies was performed by very interdisciplinary teams, so I wanted to make sure that I called that out. David Lyden Staley was the lead of the first part, with Professor Perry Zern doing the historical philosophical work. Dale Zoe in neuroscience also contributed, as well as Anne Sizemore-Blevins. In part two, so this was where we studied scientific curiosity in Wikipedia, that was led by Harang Xu. And it was in collaboration with Judy Kaplan from the History of Science and Julio Tuma from Philosophy of Science at the University of Pennsylvania. And in the third section, that was where we assessed, where Shubhankar Patankar assessed these three different psychological theories of curiosity. We particularly used ideas about conformational change in networks that were developed by Jason Kim when he was a PhD student in the lab. He's now a postdoc at Cornell. And we also used the network compressibility ideas from Chris Lin. They were developed when he was a graduate student in physics with me. He's now a postdoc at Princeton University. They were also done in collaboration with Matthew, who is a graduate student in the Electrical and Systems Engineering Department. So with that, I wanted to thank you all for listening and be happy to take questions. Thanks.
Thank you.